OMTG.
Round of applause. There's no R in any of that, but I thought I'd throw it there anyway because, you know, it's cocktail time again, kids, 2 weeks in a row. But, you know, I ran out of cranberry juice. We're a little lack in the little mixers here on the show tonight, and we're almost out of vodka, too. So it's at a critical mass. So, and when it's at a critical mass, you know how Barbara gets in the studio audience. She gets a little nervous. Yeah, it's okay, Barbara. I've got enough to last me through the show. Yes, enough to last me through the show. Oh, so I need some Dream Heart to calm my nerves. Calm my nerves. Oh, that's lovely. Oh, that feels better. Good. Now, ladies and gentlemen, hey, kids, it's OMTG. That's right. That was Pink. Singing somewhere over the rainbow, as Amanda would put it, over the rainbow, on the recent Oscars Academy Awards broadcast. I loved it. Now, you know, our fabulous fill-in co-host, Miss Amanda Gary, who's not feeling well tonight, and neither is our other co-host, who's a sudden fit of the tummy aches and is not being able to keep anything down, Puppet Schnelsley. Everybody's a wreck tonight, except for your semi-sober host, TG. So, I'm just saying, because a good, well, you know, it's Diet Coke and vodka. I'm not a real big fan, but you know, beggars can't be choosers. And right now, I'm just going to have to deal with it. So, let me welcome you to our 25th show. Oh my God, 25 shows. I think that deserves a round of applause. Yeah. Thank God for our 20-cent show budget, and I've left 24 cents in the kitty to spend wisely on future sound effects. So thanks for our studio audience, all five people tonight, for showing up and supporting us. So, hey, kids, you know, tonight on the show, we have Broadway, TV, film, pardon me, and web series star David Pevsner. David Pevsner, I first saw him when I lived in New York City in the mid-90s. And I went to see a couple of shows off-Broadway over the course of time. And I think I saw them both with my dearly departed friend, Dr. Frank Glenn of Bowling Green State University and Huron Playhouse fame. Wonderful, wonderful man, one of my dearest friends ever, passed away several summers ago. And he would visit me in New York, and we'd go see lots of other shows. And so we went to see David. Well, we didn't know him at the time. But I went to see a play called... a musical, actually, called When Pigs Fly. And he was in that. And then I saw another show at the John Houseman Theater off-Broadway on 10th, I believe, 10th and 42nd, and saw Party. And he was also in that play. He is a New York theater veteran and moved out to L.A. A handful of years ago and has since done a lot of television and film and is now, you know, segued into the world of web series. So we'll talk to him later in the show when he comes on. And I'm a little bummed tonight that our little favorite dialect wizard and actress extraordinaire, the one and the only, Tavit Schmelzley, will not be able to join us this evening because she's not feeling well. So we wish her well. And we wish our lovely Amanda as well. Here, Michael, drink some more. Hold on a second, kids. That is delicious. Not really, but I'm just going to say that anyway. Now, before we cross the street, we must look both ways. I want to remind our listeners that if you have missed any of our shows, you can catch all of our previous show recordings at spreaker.com/show/OH_MTG. And every time you listen to an OMTG show, a gay angel wins the disco ball trophy on Dancing with the Stars. Literally, with the stars. Yeah, I know. No, and that was not another earthquake, kids. That was not another earthquake in Los Angeles. But we did have one the other morning. Yes. A 4.4 earthquake hit us here in Los Angeles, and my God, you would have thought it was the end of the world, and that's all they could talk about. They were on the news. They were calling everybody they could. They were calling Sheila in Encino. They were calling Sally in Pasadena. They were calling Frank in downtown Los Angeles, asking everybody what it felt like. And, you know, it was a little bit of a shaker, and it did wake me up. But it was not a big deal, honey. All it did was mess my bedhead a little. That's all it did. It mussed my hair a little, and that's all. There's nothing to worry about. But a good reminder, a very good reminder, that this is, as they call it, earthquake country. And it is important to have an earthquake kit in your car for everybody. And also in your home. And make sure that, you know, have at least a half a tank of gas in your car. Make sure you have plenty of water and dry good foods. And, you know, you got to be in a bomb shelter. It's all that kind of stuff that you would have at the ready should the big one hit and all of your regular services that you would have access to, all your regular public services and goods and that you would need to survive on a day-to-day basis, you make sure that you have enough to get going and keep yourself safe and well-fed and well-hydrated. So it's an important reminder, as we had this little tumbler the other day, which was near, I believe, the west side of Los Angeles. So not too far from where I live here in Los Angeles. But we are all fine, so no worries about that. What I'm more concerned about, of course, is with Malaysia Airlines Flight 370. We tape our shows here on Tuesday nights and release them on Wednesdays here at OMTG on the LNR Radio Network. And so the plane disappeared March 8th. Right now it's March 18th, 10 days later. And as of the time that we're doing the show tonight, there is no indication whatsoever what happened to this plane. At last count, there were up to 25, 26 countries involved in the search. So we shall see, hopefully soon, get some definitive answers, not just for ourselves, but for the families of those on board that plane. It's important that they have answers and that they know what has happened to their loved ones, more important than for our own sense of well-being. It's important that those families know what's going on with their family members. We wish them well, and we keep them in our thoughts and our prayers. And moving along, I think it's really important. Let's give a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give a big round of applause to our 2014 American Paralympics Olympic team members for such a fabulous job. The American Paralympics team in Sochi, Russia, eighth, they said overall in terms of the gold medal count, but in terms of the overall medal finish, the Team USA was third. Now, wonderful, wonderful kudos, kudos, kudos to our men's hockey team for winning their second consecutive Paralympics Winter Games gold medal. I think that is just terrific. That is just wonderful. And I don't know about you, but if you have a chance, go online. Now, commercials rarely, you know, tug at your heartstrings to the point where you remember them and they really make you cry. But this Procter & Gamble's Thank You Mom, Tough Love commercial, I encourage you, go online, go to YouTube and look up Procter & Gamble Thank You Mom, Tough Love commercial. And if that doesn't melt your heart, I don't know what will. A wonderful, wonderful tribute to the mothers of the Paralympic athletes and the challenges and struggles that they've gone through and the commitments that they've shown and the love, the intense, unconditional, amazing, bountiful love that they show their children. And it's resulted in, you know, these kids going out there and thinking and knowing, not just thinking, but knowing in their hearts that they can do anything. And our Olympic medalists at the Paralympics have proven that. Team USA, third place overall finish in the medal count with 18. Russia, God love them, Russia had, but the USA finished with 2 gold, 7 silver, 9 bronze. The top 5 countries were Russia with 80, Ukraine with 25, interesting, right? USA with 18, Canada with 16, and Germany with 15. I don't know what they're feeding them over there in Russia. My goodness, that's pretty amazing. So kudos to the Russian Paralympians, and kudos to all Paralympians for going there and showing the world what they're capable of. It's really, really I think it's pretty, pretty amazing. And on that note, I think we should all celebrate the good times that they are feeling right now in their hearts. All of our Paralympic medalists, all of our Paralympians, all over the world, thank you, and this is for you. Great, good times. Come on. This is your host, OMTG. That's OHMTG. Michael Taylor Gray here, flying solo tonight, because my co-hosts are not feeling well. That's okay. I wish them well. We wish them well. Now, normally, we would be going into this next segment called...
When you hear the call, you got to get it underway. Word up.
Word up. But, alas, there was no word up this week, kids. That's right. Sometimes there is no pudding. Sometimes there is no pudding, and you just have to move on. That's okay. But you're in for a treat. You're in for a treat because, ladies and gentlemen, this week's shits and giggles are crap that makes you laugh. Well, you know, last couple of weeks it's been, you know, Florida and Walmart. So we thought we'd give Florida and Walmart a break. And, you know, normally I find a shits and giggles story that really indeed does make you laugh. If you want grammar, you ain't getting it here, kids. Not tonight. Shits and giggles are crap that makes you laugh. Normally, this particular segment, I find a story that gives you one of those slices of life. Okay, let me drink. Okay. Normally, you get one of those slice of life moments that happens all around us that really kind of makes us, really indeed does make us laugh. But then there are those times when folks think they're being funny. And, oh, no. They are most certainly not at all funny. And here is a recent classic bad example. This week's story is titled Disgusting Ad, Jokes About Incest and Child Abuse. I found this on HuffingtonPost.com. The HuffingtonPost.com, HuffingtonPost.com, weird news. They know what they're doing there. They get some really great stories. But I thought this one is a poignant one and something, listen up, kids, here it goes. Social media users are scolding a creepy ad that jokes about incest and pedophilia to sell socks. That's right, to sell socks. Adweek called attention to the spot from Burlington, France. The short video, which was released in October, has sparked outrage among viewers on YouTube. The ad's title, Can You Sock Me?, telegraphs the premise of a young boy asking the question to his mother, who eagerly obliges in this double entendre drivel. And that's not even the latest schlock from the European sock company, which appears to have a legitimate Facebook page packed with negative comments. The company's new ad features a young man killing his hospitalized grandpa so he could take his socks. The majority of YouTubers, both English and French-speaking, expressed disgust, and rightly so, with the can-you-sock-me bit. Someone looked at this and thought it was a good idea. Think about that for a moment, one wrote. Another penned, fuck you, Burlington. Todd molestation jokes aren't a good way to sell your crap. Pants and pleases, it looks like pain surprises. The Parisian agency behind the videos displays the Burlington work on its Facebook page. Burlington France's Facebook page does as well. Now, Slate in France confirmed the ad is not a fake, though Adweek noted that it's unclear whether or not the Parisian agency behind the videos is making these ads for a legitimate ad contract. Charmed, I'm sure. This was one of those instances where this joke simply did not fly. Disgusting ad jokes about incest and child abuse. Yes, Burlington, France, their ad, Can You Sock Me? Check it out and let them know how you feel about it, kids, because it's not funny. So, you know, and just having been a victim myself of sexual abuse from a relative and from a childhood classmate's father, two separate incidents in my life. I think it's really, you know, it hits close to home here. And that's an issue that it hits close to a lot of people's homes. So it's really, really in poor taste. So, you know, come on, kids. You can do better than that. So, good right along. And, you know, I'm so glad that, you know, actually I have a little time here tonight to add a little bit more music. And I know Tuffet's not feeling well this evening, and I know how she feels about this next song, so hopefully it'll help her heal and help her feel better. Because nothing, honey, nothing will ever knock you down. No, they can yell timber all they want. You're going to keep standing, honey. I have faith in you. Here goes.
Going down, I'm yelling timber, you better move, you better dance, let's make a night, you won't remember, I'll be the one, you won't forget.
Hi, David.
Hey.
How are you? Ladies and gentlemen, you know, when we stop the music like that, you know, when we stop the music like that and the doorbell rings, that means our guest is here. David, were you lurking outside the door dancing to the music?
Absolutely. Oh, yes, absolutely.
Well, you can bust a move. Ladies and gentlemen, it's David Pevsner. Hey, it's David. Speaking
that
of music,
like a very full crowd you got there.
Are they full? Let me tell you, I got them plied with alcohol. That's why I'm down
Woo-hoo.
To about a 2 fingers worth of vodka and a bottle of Diet Coke, and that's all we have tonight at the bar. It's not like on Hollywood Game Night with Jane Lynch where they have a full bar. We're working on it. We have a half a bottle of
Just
Coke,
get bigger.
A little
get
bit of
bigger
vodka
and bigger, and you can do that next year.
I'm trying, but you know we want to bring you on the show. And we want to do it properly. So we found a song I think it's kind of like your theme song, and this is the way you feel about the world. This is what everybody says, but this is not what you do. So here goes.
Thank you.
says don't. Everybody says don't. It isn't right. Don't. It isn't nice. Everybody says don't. Everybody says don't. Everybody says don't walk on the grass. Don't disturb the peace. Don't skate on the ice. Grass, it was meant to feel. I say sail, tilt at the windmill, and if you fail, you fail. Everybody says don't, everybody says don't, everybody says don't get out of line. When they say that, then, lady, that's a sign. My time's out of ten. Lady, you are doing just fine. Make just a ripple. Come on, be brave.
It was the choreography that you were doing in the studio. It was mesmerizing.
Well, yeah, I know. But,
mesmerizing. I know.
But you still can't cut
off
Barbra.
You know, everybody
Streisand.
Says don't. I know. But, you know, sometimes Barbra, she needed to clear her throat. So I was giving her a chance.
That's what happened. Okay.
She did that. She wasn't happy with the microphone. But, you know, she wasn't using that white microphone that she likes so much. So she
had
to go switch that out.
Yeah.
She went to color me mine, and she needed to go paint her microphone right away. Yeah, she
painted
she
it
Barbra
Streisand pink.
She did because
she
can't.
She had the color named after.
Yeah, that's why she's. Yeah, that's why she's Barbra, not Barbra. Yeah,
that's it, exactly.
That's the key.
Okay.
That's the key. So everybody says, ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big Broadway and World Wide Web welcome to our featured guest this evening, David Pevsner. Hey, David. I'm so glad you could be here.
Hello, everybody.
Hello. You know, we invited all your friends to the show, plus mine. That makes five. So we're good. We're good. We got a full house.
The four
tonight.
Of them are yours.
Right. The four.
Yeah.
David, please. I'm your friend, too. So you can count me. You can count me twice. So, now. Everybody says don't. What was it about that song, David, that spoke to your heart, besides it being Barbra Streisand?
Well, I was singing it way before Barbra Streisand. No, that was one of my first audition songs back in New York in 1982.
Really?
Yeah. I've been singing that goddamn song for 30-something years.
You've been carrying that song in a trunk.
It's in my trunk. It's sitting there just waiting for me to pull it out. Every so often I'll pull it out. But what's funny about it is that it just, you know, as you get older and you get sort of more secure with yourself, the song has taken on so much, you know, it means something different every few years to me. And I just love it. I think it's a great song. And I actually sang it once I auditioned for the Broadway production of Gypsy back in 1987 or 88 or whatever. And I knew the assistant director, and he said to me, and I sang that for Arthur Lawrence, you know, who directed the show. And I thought, you know, okay. Well, so afterwards, I saw my friend. He goes, David, he said, you know, Arthur Lawrence said you sang that better than anybody he's ever heard. It made him cry. But I didn't get the job.
Arthur Lawrence said that?
He said that to my
friend. Oh, my God, kids, if you don't know who Arthur Lawrence is, check it out. Spell Arthur Lawrence's last name for the kids who are listening to this show.
L-A-U-R-E-N-T-S. L-A-U-R-E-N-T-S. And I'm not saying that like to
Arthur
toot
Lawrence.
My horn, because there are people who sing that song way better than I do, but there is something about sort of how I, like, my understanding of it and what it means to me. I think sometimes, you know, you don't have to be the greatest singer in the world, but you got to throw your heart into it. So, boom. But I did not get that job, so what can you do? Wah, wah.
Go ahead and toot your own horn. I think you should toot. I've seen your horn, and it's lovely. You should toot it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm proud of my horn. What?
But, you know, you bring up a really good point, because that was one of the greatest lessons I think I ever learned. When I went to grad school at CalArts, I got my MFA there back in 1893. Yes, I said 1893. Christine Somadamore. Oh, well, thanks, honey. Liposuction and Restylane and that filler, that instead of that flat tire in a can, it's great. It's great when you're on a budget. So, no, Christine Somanamore was a wonderful vocal coach at CalArts. And she really, and you really hit it right on the head. It's not about necessarily the quality that you have as a singer, but how you tell the story. And she really taught me to tell, who are you singing to? And why are you singing to them? What story are you telling? And what we, all of us who studied with her really got that. Oh my God, you know, it's one thing to have an individual lesson, but then we would have our master class like once a week.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a cry fest, you know, because everybody, along the way, somebody would have that moment where they really got it. And it wasn't about how they sounded, but how they told the story. And so kudos to you. You do have a fine voice, by the way. So
there are way better voices out there. But what I've learned about singing, but about any aspect of the arts, it's like, you know, you walk into a room and there's, you know, 20 people who look exactly like you, who are up for the same role, and they can probably all really good actors. But it feels like the more you know why you identify with what you're saying, what you're singing, what you bring to it, there's an understanding that you will bring to it that nobody else will. And that's why you sort of have to personalize everything that you bring in, even if it's a character that's way different than you. You still have to find out, like, okay, how am I like that serial killer? And then you really have, you know, you infuse yourself into it, and then nobody else does it like you. And if that's what they're looking for, you got it. It's a really great process, I think. But it took me years to sort of understand it.
And it's that embracing of that, of one's own unique qualities. Because everybody, everybody is, that makes you stand out. And then people go, God, there's something about David that I really like. What is it about him? But I think those fully realized kind of people, like, you know, somebody like Meryl Streep, God love her, and probably the most fully realized actor, you know.
Oh, from the minute
in our
she,
time,
like,
you know,
stepped out of the womb, I'm
she
sure.
She knows, yeah. And so, I mean, she fully knows what her strengths are and who she is. And she plays to them, and I think that's why what she does is so rich. And, you know, and I've enjoyed your work. You know, as I've mentioned to you, let me just give our audience a little bit of a background on
like,
some of
the
past
hell
projects.
Now,
hell the hell is David Pevsner? I can't
David
even call his name alone.
What? Yeah.
Well, honey, if we were on Wheel of Fortune, we'd be winning lots of money because you got lots of consonants in your
name.
Don't buy a vowel. Could you lose $250
of $50
time? Why would you do that? It's a waste, isn't it? Yes, I always thought,
yes.
Why do people do that when they know what it is? So in film, some of the highlights that you've mentioned are Scrooge and Marley, Joshua Tree, 1951. I'm sorry, Scrooge and Marley's Joshua Tree, 1951, A Portrait of James Dean, role play, and a lifetime... Yes. I know you like to role play, honey. That's another story. Now, the Lifetime TV movie, Liz and Dick, as Lindsay Lohan's doctor. No, notice I said Lindsay Lohan, not Lindsay Lohan.
Oh, I like to say
Lindsay
Lohan.
I know, but that's not how you pronounce
Lindsay Lohan. Okay.
It's Lohan, just like it's Ralph Lauren, not Ralph Lauren. I don't know why that bugs me, but it does, kids. It's time for another drink. Are you drinking tonight?
I'm not.
You're not having a cocktail?
No cocktail for me
fine.
Right now, no.
No cocktail. I got
stuff to do. I got to have all my capabilities.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, who needs their faculties? Well, that's overrated. So, so that's some of the stuff that you've done in film. TV, Modern Family, Grey's Anatomy. A Broadway, Fiddler on the Roof, I saw an unfortunate version of Rosie O'Donnell. You weren't in that one, were you?
I was not.
Were you in that one?
But I have to say, when I did...
I mean, everybody else is fabulous.
Alfred, was it Harvey Fierstein or Alfred Molina?
I think it was Harvey.
Okay.
Yeah.
No,
there were some other fine voices.
I met Alfred Molina when I did Law & Order LA, and he was just the nicest, nicest person in the entire world. And we told war stories about doing Fiddler on the Roof on Broadway. Great experience, but it comes with baggage, you know.
Right.
Even,
I love it. That's what. He teaches here in town, a very good friend of mine. a CalArts, a fellow CalArts grad, Anastasia Roussel. She and she's been taking classes with him, and part of the I can't think of the name of the. But anyway, yeah, she's spoken.
When I tell you the nicest, most genuine person I've ever met on a show.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's just
terrific,
great.
Terrific actor.
Great actor,
yeah, yeah.
But so present in life, you know, just really nice.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Now, as
I'm sorry,
my dear.
I dropped the name. I'm sorry. I have to pick it up now.
You've dropped so many names. We're going to need a bigger broom. We're going to need a bigger broom to clean off the floor. I'm saying. Now, what? As I mentioned earlier, before you came onto the show tonight, while you were doing your nightly jog to the show, because you're very fit, and if anybody knows you and has seen you, ladies and gentlemen, he is truly indeed a silver fox. Now, I may have gray hair now, but David Pevsner is a silver fox. Oh,
you
honey.
You are perennially cherubic, though. You will, when you're 90, you're going to look like you're 35.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, we love him. We love David. Don't you love David? You're sweet. I love you. I'm going to keep you forever. Now, as I mentioned earlier.
Just stay away. Just try not to get osteoporosis so you can still stand up straight. But then you'll still look 35.
Well, that's why I'm taking my. And I'm hunching right now. You noticed.
Don't hunch.
Sorry.
Don't.
It starts now.
Well,
I know. I don't hunch, but don't hunch. Yeah, I know. I've been taking my calcium, and I feel like Sally Field.
Good.
I'm not on a Breva, but I do take calcium and a vitamin D supplement, thanks to my doctor, Dr. Ashley. I'm with her at the L.A. Gay and Lesbian Center, the Jeffrey Goodman Clinic. They are incredible there. They are incredible there. So I encourage people to look them up online and check out what they do. They're fantastic. Now, David,
yeah.
I first got wind of you when I lived in New York, but you had no idea. You had no idea I even existed. And I've told you the story before. I went to the John Houseman Theater to see you in When Pigs Fly. Now, I didn't know you at that time. So that's when I first saw you perform. My good friend, Randall Reggett, was of Iowa Boy Productions. He was a very dear friend of mine. He passed away, unfortunately, several years ago. He became a prolific producer of Broadway. And he started out with doing PR. And Randall and I became very dear friends. And he was doing PR for your show. And he took me to see it. And I fell in love with When Pigs Fly. And I said, I will not leave this earth until I do that play. And I was fortunate enough to do it in Palm Springs in 2004.
Oh, no, I didn't
know
that.
At the Palm Theater. Yeah, I played Howard Crabtree.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
It really is such a fantastic show.
Yeah. And I performed, and Jerry Herman came to see the show. Jerry Herman.
Oh, my gosh.
I'm dropping a name. Jerry Herman heard me sing. Yeah. That was
fantastic.
Talk about nerve wracking. He came to see us. He came to the dressing room before the show. So I was.
Ouch.
Yeah, I was. Exactly. So I was like, really? So that was something. But yeah, so David, you inspired me. And then I saw you at the same theater in Party.
You saw Party first. Party was there first.
Oh, okay.
So you saw the naked play first.
I'm drinking tonight. Yeah, so when you really put it out there, ladies and gentlemen.
Chronology is everything.
Lovely. It is. Chronology is everything.
Yes.
Oh, it is. So I saw you in Party, and then I saw you in When Pigs Fly. So,
yes.
And, you know, immediately a fan of your work. I think you're terrific. And
thank you.
As a writer, you're welcome, my dear. As a writer, David's songs have been heard in the film Adam and Steve, both the stage and film versions of Naked Boy Singing's his song, Perky Little Porn Star, and the musical revue, Fancy Boys Follies. David has also written and performed his own one-man shows, To Bitter and Back, and musical comedy Whore, something I think that we all are this evening. We're all musical comedy whores. So,
yay.
I mean, it's terrific. Yeah. So, I mean, you're like allspice. You are like, when it comes to seasoned actors, you're like allspice. You got a little bit of everything. And
Well, yeah, there's a lot of hats there, but for years, you struggle when you put a lot out there and you sit there and going, am I just like a jack of all trades and master of none? But, you know, you just keep plugging away at everything a little bit every day. So hopefully, you know, you do become a master of whatever.
But I would say
a master of whatever it is that you do.
I wouldn't say that you're a jack of all trades and a master of none. I'd say that, you know, some of your work, and you can deny it if you want, some of your work has been masterful. So you have mastered at times, as we all have. I think you're really talented. What I love about your work is the level of honesty and the vulnerability that you allow yourself, how you allow yourself to really go as deep as you can. And I really feel like you leave it all on the table. I don't see you acting and I really have enjoyed that about your work. There's a real, always such a gut level of honesty in the work that you do. So I really appreciate what you bring to the table.
Well, thank you for that.
You're welcome, David. This is a love.
I heartily agree.
Are you feeling the love? Are you feeling the love?
Feeling love. I'm sitting here in my studio apartment, all alone in my. I'm in the studio with you, and we're dancing.
Yeah. You're in the studio. Here at OMTG, it's luxurious. You're in that cute little fitted sort of, it looks like a, what is that? Is that like an Italian cut? Is that a Gucci kind of really? It's just a very fitted pants that you have on this evening. They fit you quite nicely.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
I wanted to dress up just for you.
Well, you know, I appreciate it because, you know, I don't get out much. So, you know, you're bringing
you
the outside
stay in
world
studio
in.
Studio all day, huh?
I do. Well, I'm not doing the show. I'm working on the show. And, you know, that's just the way it goes. That's what we do for our art. And speaking of our art, that is what we do. And your current projects include, I love that, you know, because you've gone from, I knew you first as a stage actor, and you still are a wonderful stage actor, always will be, television, film. And now with the advent of web series, and now you see, you know, you have Hulu, you have Amazon, you have all these online presence, all these online production companies and businesses that are producing their own serialized content now. And Orange is the New Black, House of Cards, you're getting some really high-level stuff. So that's really helping our community of web series really start to get more notice. And so you're doing two web series right now, Old Dogs and Tricks, your season 3 debuts. Has it already debuted or is it coming up?
We're shooting it right now as we speak. Next month we're shooting.
Very good.
There's a special episode that we shot a few months ago, which will be the opening two episodes of the season. And then we're shooting 8 more episodes. That will wrap early April. And then I don't know exactly when they go on. I don't know.
Oh.
Nobody tells me nothing.
Well, right. And the series creator, Leon Accord. So I guess it's up to Leon.
Acord.
When those are going to be released. Acorn.
Make sure you say
Acorn, whatever.
Like Acorn.
See?
If he comes on your show.
Leon Acorn.
Lindsay Lohan and Leon.
Lindsay Lohan.
Yeah.
Leon.
And Leon
Acorn.
Beautiful.
Thank you for that correction.
Yes.
See, I'm not above learning. In every OMTG show, we have a learning moment. I'm not above, and David's not above correcting me on the show. On my own show. But that's okay. That's okay.
That's
we embrace that. We embrace that. Don't we not? Yes, we do.
My vulnerability and my honesty.
Yeah, it is. It is. I appreciate that about you. So Old Dogs and New Tricks, which people can see at Old Dogs New Tricks, the series.
I think it's Old Dogs and New Tricks, the series.
Are you sure?
I believe. I think so. Mm. I could be wrong.
I think
well,
it's
maybe
Old
now
Dogs, New Tricks, the series.com. You might want to look that up.
Okay. Yeah.
Let's look that up right now. Okay, I'm going to type it in my little studio dashboard. Old Dogs.
Gosh, it'd be good for me to know too if I'm doing press for my own very my very own show. Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Geek.
Yeah. Now I do my homework. I may not pronounce Leon Acord correctly, but I do now because I've learned. Yes, it is indeed. It is indeed. We don't need to see the www dot anymore because it's understood. So it's olddogsnewtricksthesereas.com. And so I had, see, David, I got to correct you.
See? I am the worst.
Isn't it great? Yeah.
Show beater in the entire world.
Yeah.
Okay.
I love it. But you've already improved. Thanks to me. Thanks to me. So, yeah.
Thank
so
you, Michael.
Old dogs, new tricks. You're welcome, David Pevsner. I love you. Always have. Always have. Always have. Even when you know I didn't exist. When I didn't exist. If you want grammar, you're not getting
I
love
you in my soul, though. I knew you were there in my soul.
I do. John Houseman. You remember the John Houseman Theater, New York City, 42nd and 10th Street, correct? Am I right?
Yes, I had 3 years there.
Thank you. Yes, you did. So, When Pigs Fly. It was the night the blizzard hit, and it was 95, 96. And you were on the payphone in the lobby. Payphone, ladies and gentlemen. This is before I had a laptop. This is before I had a computer and or a cell phone. David was on the payphone in the lobby of the John Houseman. And it had snowed so much that day. The theater was kind of inset off the street, and it was a little bit of a courtyard out there that led to the street.
Yeah.
And the snow had blown in. It had there was a snow drift that had blown up, and it was like probably 2 or 3 feet high up against the door. So there was somebody out there in the courtyard with a snowblower blowing a path, clearing a path, so that we could actually get out of the theater and get back onto the street. So after the show, and I remember seeing you on the phone, at the payphone. The payphone. He put in at least 2 quarters. I thought, oh my God, he's so cute. He's so cute, and he's so talented. And I was like so nervous. I don't know if I said hello. I can't remember if I said anything to you, but I didn't want to bother you because you were on the phone. You know, it's like if you were eating, I wouldn't want to bother you. If you were at a restaurant, I wouldn't want to bother you.
I don't remember any of it. I don't remember the blizzard. I don't remember the 2-foot snowdrift. I
remember
nothing.
I
remember nothing.
I saw Hello Dolly, Carol Channing, and then I came to see you for a second time in When Pigs Fly. A second time. Yeah, because I saw it a second time with my friend Frank Land, who has since. Oh my God, what is it about people who see your show and they pass away? Both Randall and Frank have passed away. God love them. Amazing, wonderful lovers of the theater. And thanks to them, you know, I saw a lot of theater when I lived in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And So
it was always nice to know somebody working on the shows. When you're, you know, when you're struggling and you can barely buy dinner, boy, does it help to have publicist friends.
Oh, yeah, because I saw I think he went to this for my third. I turned 30 in New York at the time, so it was 96. Randall took me to go see in the Theater of the Round, The Imaginary Invalid. I don't know if you remember the Circle. Yeah, Theater of the Round. Was it the Circle Theater?
Circle in the Square.
Circle
in the Square.
Jesus Christ! Yeah. Right. I was never really good at math either, David. The geometry, look, circle in the square.
Triangle in the rectangle. In
triangle
the,
in the hypotheses. I
went
to see
theater
triangle 50, in the hypotheses.
50th Street. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so I saw that there with him as well. And we saw a ton of stuff together, so it was a lot of fun. God love him. God love him.
Yeah.
So anyway, so the other, listen to me. What a nice segue. So anyway, the other web series that you're in, I know, isn't that lovely? Is Disorganized Zone.
Yes.
Disorganized Zone, a web series.
Yes.
Actress Judy Norton from The Waltons.
From The Waltons.
And tell us a little bit about from The Waltons. Now, yes, which I loved. Dun, dun, da, da, dun, dun.
Good night, John Boy.
What is that? Yeah, good night. Good night, Grandpa. Why is John Boy touching me in my private spot? Go to sleep.
Hey, don't soil that show.
Private. I know. My dad used to make fun
Look,
of
you,
us.
You know me. I like filthy and dirty, too, but you do not touch the Waltons. Oh, no.
Oh, no pun intended. You do not touch the Waltons. Okay.
Do not.
Yes. Disorganized.
Don't sully the Waltons.
Series with actress Judy Norton. So tell us a little bit about that, because you were sort of the Rod Serling host for this show.
Right. That's,
and
that's
tell us a little bit about Disorganized Zone. What's that?
Well, it hasn't started yet. It'll be starting shortly, I believe. It was created by a woman named Cindy Seidler, who's a personal organizer, and it's a web series about a personal organizer played by Judy. And the funny thing is that I have a side business as a personal organizer. It's called Address the Mess. So she didn't know that when they asked me to do the series. I was like, well, you know, I do that for, you know, as a side living. They just thought it was hilarious because there are so many hilarious, amazing stories and how people, like, the psychology of organizing. So that's sort of what each episode is about. And I do all these sort of, like, intros and outros, like, you know, the Rod Serling character who sort of sums it all up and sort of tells the audience what they're going to see and what they've learned from it. And, yeah, we shot a bunch of episodes, and I think we're supposed to go shoot some more next month. Nobody tells me anything, like I said. But that, just look for it. I think it's the disorganizedzone.com. Is that right? You probably know better than I do.
Let me tell you what it is, David. Let me tell you about your show. Your show is
disorganized. I think my personal website is davidpevsner.com, but I'm not sure.
I have no idea. Yeah. No, it's disorganized.
I could be wrong.
Zone.
It could be michaeltaylorgray.com for all I know.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen. If you want to know anything about David Pevsner, go to
michaeltaylorgray.com.
Yes. That's sage advice. I like the way you think. Okay, now, in upcoming projects, because you have past, you have current, and you have future. David, I'm telling you, you are very organized when it comes to just having it all together with, you know, with the past, current, and future. I think it's terrific, you know. You are a one-man show, indeed a one-man show. It's no coincidence that you've written and performed in two. You are a one-man show. So your upcoming projects are Waiting in the Wings, the musical, written by Jeffrey Johns.
Do you know Jeffrey?
I think I do. He's in a web series, isn't he?
Oh, you're kidding.
Huh?
Jeffrey did the Los Angeles revival of Naked Boys singing. He sang a song of mine. And, you know, we became friendly. And then all of a sudden he's written this movie that he's co-producing and has raised all the money for, and there's a role in it for me to come and audition for. And this kid gets this movie up through sheer willpower. It's the most impressive thing in the entire world. He's totally the Ever Ready Bunny. And I've heard the film is very funny. We all had such a great time working on it. I believe we're actually going to the first screening of it April 1st. So it's very exciting. It's exciting for us. It's fun. But for him, it was such an achievement to have somebody say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this, and I'm going to start from scratch. I mean, that's what he did, you know, and he got some great people involved with it. It's crazy.
Yeah. All right. Thank you for saying that. That's lovely that you said. I'm sure Jeffrey will appreciate that sentiment. And it's all in the doing. And I posted tonight. Tonight, OMTG, for the shows that we've done thus far, we have a total of we hit our 2,000th listen tonight.
Wow.
So, now, in the greater scheme of things, that might not seem like a lot. But you know what? When you're doing it, every step is a milestone. And so when you hit that 500th show, that 1,000th, 2,000, I was watching it all day today. And when I finally hit that 2,000th listen right before we went on the air tonight, I was so excited. And I wanted to post that, and I did. And,
well, congratulations.
And people have been very supportive. Well, thank you. And like you said about Jeffrey Johns, about producing Waiting in the Wings, the musical, taking it from an idea, talking about it, and taking it from the try to the do. You know, it's not about trying. It's about doing it. And he's doing it. And so kudos to him. And it's lovely that you said what you said. And I'm proud of you for being a part of it. And it's, you know, and that he included you in that process. So that's exciting that it's happening.
It's tough. I
say
more so now than when I lived in New York, but especially living out here. You know, there's a lot of actors out here. There's a lot of artists out here. But there's a lot of people who, and I, you know, I've been there. I went through my bohemian period where I was like, you know, sitting at a coffee shop with my shirt off, making phone calls and writing a little bit, but mostly enjoying the sun and thinking, like, am I an artist or am I, you know, what am I? And the thing is, if you're going to be an artist, you got to be an artist. You got to do it. And a lot of what's great about the people that I know you, it's like you didn't just sit at home and went, gee, I wish I had a radio show. I wish I had a talk show. I wish I could talk to artists and, you know, oh, well, it's never going to happen. No, here we are. You're doing it. And it's the same thing with me when I started writing. Being, like, when you're not acting, when, you know, you have to audition for things, you have to get in shows, you can, and if they're not going to hire you right away because you're not right for this or this or that, then you have to figure it out yourself. And so that's one of the reasons why
I started
writing, so I could write stuff for me and my friends, and that, to me, just gave me so much more joy than just sitting and waiting for the phone to ring, because I could actually use everything I have every day of my life, you know? And so when people act, and then you've got to get the project up, and that's the difficult thing.
It's in, but once you start the ball rolling, once you start doing it, then I'm having the best time with this. Is it a lot of work? But did you say it? The difference between the meaning of success is that fine line between not knowing if it's work or fun.
Well, I've never said
that's
that.
When you,
I mean, I've always said that. I mean, I don't know if I said it to you, but, you know, they say that thing that if you do what you love, you'll never work a day in your life.
Yeah.
Well, look, it is hard work, and it is. There are things about it that you know, technically you probably don't like to do. But overall, it's like when you have the passion to do this, it almost doesn't seem like the hours go by and you go, wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
You know, and then you get the finished product, and this always goes fast. You know, when you do an interview and stuff, when you're having fun, it's like, oh, it's over already? It's because, you know, there's a passion behind it. You know, I have a lot of friends who write, and one of the things that they're always afraid of is they're like, well, you know, it's not good enough yet, and I don't know. And I'm like, no, here's the first thing you do. And I would tell this to anybody out there who has written something. It's like, get some chips and a little bottle of wine and sit in your living room and grab some actors and just read it. Just read. It doesn't cost a penny except for whatever you pay for the wine. And just hear it. It's so inspiring to hear your words being read out loud. And that's what I like to do is, you know, whenever I write anything, start out small just to hear it. And it makes you kind of go, look, I am putting this out there. It's the smallest way of putting it out there, but it's just the start.
Yeah, and as an actor, I really enjoy. I still do a lot of stage readings and
when
I'm organizing
it
or being a part of it. Yeah, I love it. I love supporting new work, and so I encourage it. And with this show, I get the opportunity not only just to help people bring on a lot of really really wonderful, talented, and really buried artists onto the show and talk about some of the things that they're doing. But I really like getting to the heart of who people are, you know, and when you create your own work, that's the nitty gritty of it all that I love. And I love that you've been able to not only, you know, audition and be in shows that you find really rewarding, but to get to the point where you're able to write and produce and star in your own stuff. And then to hear, I didn't know that you wrote as much as you did. So what was it like for you to hear, like, on stage and then in the film version of Naked Boy Singing? How wonderful was that to hear Perky Little Porn Star and know, I wrote that?
Well, it's funny about that is that, I wrote, those were the first songs I ever wrote. A friend of mine said they're looking for songs for this revue in L.A. I was living in New York at the time. And I only started writing songs because I thought When Pigs Fly was so funny and clever, and I thought, I sort of think that way, but I'm a little filthier than that. So I started writing these filthy little songs that sort of made me laugh.
I knew I liked
and,
you.
That's me. And then I sent them off to this review, and they ended up using three of them. And I flew into L.A. for the opening night. And, you know, it was at the Celebration Theater, which you know very well, the
Celebration Theater. Of course, yes.
Right, tiny. And the three of... Then the three songs were, you know, part of the show. But the song, I wrote a song called Fight the Urge with Rami Sciarroni. He wrote the music. I wrote the lyrics. And actually, we both wrote the music, and I wrote the lyrics. And it was that number was choreographed by Kenny Ortega, who directed the High School Musical movies and has just done tons of stuff. And
right.
And so one of my first songs was choreographed by Kenny Ortega. And I remember going to see the
wow.
show, and I saw him, and he did, like, afterwards I literally was like, I wrote that? I wrote that? Because I couldn't believe, because he did such
That's
a beautiful job staging it. And at intermission, I saw him, and he said, so how did you lie? I was like, oh, my God, Kenny. I said, it's amazing. He said, and he did an imitation of me. He said, David, you sat there through the whole first act. It's a visual. But right now my shoulders are up around my, like, my ears, you know, like stiff as a board, not breathing, watching this first half of the show. It was very exciting. And look, Make the Boys Sing is a silly, fun little show. It is what it is,
yeah.
And, you know, and it's a lot of fun. But you know what? For that to be the first stuff that I ever wrote, to get in there was just felt like a real sort of plus in my life, you know. I was like, oh, I enjoy this, and I want to do more of that. So I have, and, you know, written a couple of shows since then. And then the new show, Musical Comedy Horror, I actually did in Palm Springs over the summer, and now I'm looking to do a production here in L.A. or New York or wherever. You know, now that I'm done with my last gig, I'm putting my nose to the grindstone and going, like, how am I going to get this up? So
did you just wrapped up a play at the Mark Taper, correct?
Yes, I was. I actually understudied the role of Vanya in Vanya and Sonia and Masha and Spike, which just we actually closed on Sunday night. And it was a play
Durang,
that won the Tony
right?
Award last year, Christopher Durang. And it had a great cast here, including Christine Ebersole and Mark Blum and Christine Nielsen, who did it in New York. Just a great group of people. And it was, I hope if anybody saw it out there, it was just the greatest, with the greatest group of people. The Mark Taper Forum is a fantastic place to work. And,
yeah.
you know, it, as an understudy gig, it was a really – you still get to work on the play, you know. You don't necessarily
yeah.
get time in front
yeah.
of the audience, but you work on the play. And it was just magical. It was just a fantastic experience. So more of that,
So what
please.
Did you – because that's a really interesting experience for an actor. What
yeah.
did you – what did you get out of it as a performer? How did you improve? How did you learn? How did you grow? And just – how does that affect
doing this
you
understudy gig, you're saying?
That's a challenging position to be in. And it takes a lot of letting go of your ego.
Yes.
And just doing the work.
Yes. But, you know, it totally is about just doing the work. You treat the play as if you're going to be going on any second now. Now, you don't have the same, you don't have the luxury of the rehearsal process that they had. I mean, they rehearsed for 2 weeks
right.
in New York before they came out here. You know, and the play had already sort of been produced. David Hyde Pierce directed this production, and he was the original Vanya in New York. So it sort of it started out based on the New York production, but you know there were a lot of changes made
yeah.
for the production here. And we
did
were
he
all
direct
we did
you
from
in
the very
show
beginning.
Well?
What'd you say?
Did he
no,
direct
actually,
you
his
in
assistant.
This?
His assistant is the one who sort of did our rehearsals early on, and then the stage manager would take us further. He did watch us rehearse a little bit, but the thing is, he sort of did in that when they were putting the show into the theater for the week that they were doing that, we sat in on all their rehearsals and we heard all of his notes and we heard and David Hyde Pierce, if you've never met him, is one of the most gracious, nicest, funniest people you could ever hope to work with. So respectful of actors, so understands the process and the insecurity that comes with it. And yet he's just all about finding funny and finding sweet and finding moving. And he was just, I can't rave enough. When I think about people like Alpha Molina and David Hyde Pierce, you go, wow, in this industry, how did you stay so nice?
Yeah. It's so good to hear. It's such a welcoming thing to hear because, you know, I mean, as you know, we're in it and we, L.A. and Hollywood and the whole industry, it gets a lot of hard knocks, and many times for good reason. But, you know, it's so good to balance that out by pointing out that there are some really good eggs in this business.
Yeah.
Yourself included.
And you know what? They never made us feel like understudies. They never made us feel like, okay, if something happens, I guess you'll go on. They never felt that. They were like, you know, people on the plane, you're constantly
well, we'll
running the line.
Oh, we'll have to put you
constant.
In, kid.
Oh, well, some people have to have give the audience, you know,
David
blindfold
Pevsner.
When you come on. Yeah. No, they never made us feel that way. And David, again, you know, he just, everybody just always had great things to say, and they understood the process, especially as an understudy, where you don't have that luxury. Most of the work you do, you do on your own or with your fellow understudies, and you're not, you know, when you go on, they throw you up there pretty much, you know, once it's time. Yeah. So you got to do the work. And, you know, in the entire run, none of the understudies went on because it was a pretty hearty group of actors there going, oh, well, I wish everybody had seen. No, it was great. I mean, the experience itself was fantastic. It's a show now that they're doing all over the country. Possibly I'll do it somewhere else. Whatever. It was perfectly
terrific. So this could lead to an opportunity
experience
for you elsewhere. Oh, wow. See,
that's
really
the best
smart
regional theater in the country, you know.
Yeah, no kidding.
And Michael Ritchie.
No kidding.
Michael Ritchie's another one. He runs the Center Theater Group, one of the theaters, which is the Mark Caper Forum.
Yeah.
So accessible, so nice, so not what you would think an artistic director of a theater would be, you know. He would hang out with us, and he would tell us great stories. And, you know, I just have so much respect for the people at those theaters, and I hope that people in L.A. will, you know, if they haven't gone in a while, they should go, because there's some exciting stuff happening, you know, at those theaters.
Well, maybe I'm seeing it in my mind, David. Maybe this is another light bulb moment here on OMTG. Maybe somewhere in the near future, very near, I'm seeing you and I in a Broadway musical version, but at the Mark Taper of Some Like It High. What do you think?
There you go.
In the quintessential roles. I'm just saying.
Okay.
I'm just saying. It's going to happen.
It's a date.
It's going to happen. I see it, David. Let's make it happen. We'll do it like a little spec video. We'll put it on the YouTube, and that'll start the ball rolling. But, what's not to love? Now, what about, speaking of love, okay, now, this is March, so a mere month ago, ladies and gentlemen, David Pevsner was February 2014's deep dish, groovy guy of the month.
Love it. Mark Farnsberger. Thank you.
I needed to lighten things up for a second. Wasn't that fun? Yeah, that's because this is chat time with our featured guest, David Pevsner. Yes, Mark Harshberger, that's MarkHarshberger, markharshberger.blogspot.com. Go check it out, Deep Dish, Groovy Gay Pop Culture, Groovy Guy of the Month, David Pevsner for 2014 in February. Yes, that was you. Now, when...
Hello?
Well, that was rude. All I can say, that was rude. Can you believe that? Can you believe somebody tried to somebody tried to say no to us, David, but we're not going to have it.
No, did somebody try, what? Did somebody try to put a kibosh on this?
So I think that Vladimir Putin came into the studio, and he was trying to annex the OMTG show. And we said, look at us. We're not Crimea. You're not going to take us over. I said, for Jesus' Crimea's sake, you're not taking us over, ladies and gentlemen.
Let the gays have their conversations.
Yes. That's what I said to him. And it's no joke, that's for sure. Yes, so we are back. That was a little blip in the radar, but we found our show. Unlike, God love it, I hope they find that plane. Oh, what a segue, huh? Yeah, I hope they find that plane. That plane. So, but unlike the Malaysian Airlines, we are back. We have been found. So, too soon?
I'm not even going to make a joke. I'm not going to, like, come back on that. I'm just going to sort of laugh.
Yeah, no, I'm not. In all seriousness, I hope they find. But anyway, what I'm saying is I don't know what he was doing in the studio. Vladimir Putin, go back to Russia. You and Sarah Palin, you can solve the problems in your little worlds. So here we are. We're back, David. So like I said, you were Deep Dish Groovy Guy of the Month for February. 2014. Was it like the Oscar nominations? Did you get a call like at 5:30 in the morning from your publicist saying, David, you're the groovy guy of the month?
No, I got an email. But you know what? The thing is, I loved.
I got an email.
You're the groovy guy. But the questionnaire that he wanted to put out there, the interview, was one of the most fun interviews I'd ever, you know, have to sit and write. So it was fun, you know. He asked, you know, questions about movies and TV shows and stuff like that, and I certainly have my opinions.
Yes, you do.
It was really,
I love it.
It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, but I'm glad at least in this format we get to at least chat, you know, in the studio, have fun, and really throw it around. You can be as opinionated as you want. You know, like how you tried to tell me that the old dog's new tricks, the webseries.com, was a different web series address, and you were wrong.
Yeah,
that's okay.
Well, but I don't think I pushed that anywhere near as hard as I will most of my opinions because I just wasn't sure.
But
I'm sure.
But when you're sure, watch out.
I'm a bitch.
Watch out. Now, do you feel groovy? Are you feeling extra groovy?
Yeah.
Or was it a February kind of thing, and is it sort of dissipated a little bit from March? Are you still feeling pretty groovy?
I don't know if I'm, like, because I'm in my mid-50s, I don't know if I'm allowed to be groovy, but that was my period, though, so maybe I am. Like, maybe
okay,
the
I'll
kids
say
would
that.
Be, like, rad man of,
yeah.
of the month, but I'm groovy guy, so there you go.
Hey, you still look great naked, so all I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen, is that David can feel groovy as much as he wants. Now, Barbara is in the audience. No, Barbara, he's not going to get naked for you. Let it go. She got all excited. Barbara's very excitable in the audience. I know. Yeah. So, but, you know, feel free. If you want to, like, you know, unbutton the button a little bit, that's quite all right. I won't say
no. I'm very comfortable. Thank you.
Okay. You look comfortable. So, now let's chat a little bit about your side business as a personal organizer. It's called Address the Mess. And you may not know this, David, but the actual website address for that is addressthemess.biz.
Yes, because I couldn't get addressthemess.com because Comedy Central was going to be doing a show called Address the Mess, and they got .com. Where that show is now, I have no idea.
Yeah, and they let go of the .com? No, but that's okay. That's okay, because you have addressed the best. Address. I'm going to let that go. Addressthemess.biz.
Yeah.
So where did – because I know a lot of actors, and if you go to their apartments and their homes, they're not the neatest people. All I'm saying. Things are kind of thrown around. Yeah, you know, they may not – you know, they probably need a housekeeper. All I'm saying. So how do you stay so organized, and what is it, the gay gene? What is it?
No, it's not the gay gene. First off, I think it's, you know, partly my mom, because my mom, like, can organize things within an inch of her life. And the only video game I ever liked, we all got Game Boys when they first came out, and the only thing I ever played was Tetris, which is about what? Fitting these little boxes into boxes and making full lines. You know, that very sort of anal thing. That's just something that is a part of me. And when I go in, I've always been good at math and stuff like that. So I'm very much about, like, looking at a situation and figuring it out.
Did you say anal thing, David?
Find out that there's an actual business you can do where you can use that. It's crazy. And I really enjoy it. It's not like the side business where I'm like, oh, God, I have to do that now. I really would rather be on stage. No, I really love doing it, you know, and I do a little bit of everything. So I don't do one or the other, you know.
You ran right over my rim shot.
I didn't hear it. My hearing's not very good. Or am I
you said
talking,
anal.
Am I talking really
you said
loud?
It's an anal thing, and I said, did you say it was an anal thing?
I'll say
and that's
it again.
A punchline,
it's an anal
rim
thing.
Shot. Yeah.
Oh.
Anyway, so I know. And
I guess
you
I don't have much
one.
Of a sense of humor, but I get it now. You have to explain it.
Yeah.
You have to say it a few times, but then I got it.
Well, you know,
eventually
once we hit
get it.
A certain age, once the AARPs start coming in the mail. Oh.
Yeah.
Right.
I got the day before my 50th birthday, I got sent my AARP card and
the
my
day
appointment
before,
for my colonoscopy. There you just now you just jumped on the joke. Oh, Michael.
Say it again.
No, it's not. It's not funny the second time. No.
Come on, no, say it again.
No, just
come
that
on.
I got the card on the same day that I got. Oh, see, now I can't. I got my AARP card the same day I got my appointment for my colonoscopy. Boom. Yeah. Now it's really
perfect.
Not funny.
Oh.
Wah wah. I was gonna do that. Yeah. A big wah wah.
But you say I just had a colonoscopy this past Friday.
I know, it was all
not
over
that
Facebook.
I remember. It should be all over AskBook, but that's another site altogether. Well, I'm playing.
Is there something called AskBook?
I hope not.
Well, now,
one of my favorite things.
Be
I know, everybody's looking it up now. One of my favorite things from The View, Barbara Wawa, early on in The View, when they were talking about MySpace and Facebook and all that, and Barbara's like, what is this? What does everybody want to be on my face? And they're like, oh, Barbara, not so much.
Mm.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Who would want to be on Barbara's face? All I'm saying. Not me.
No.
Yeah, I know. So you went from Groovy Guy of the Month. Then we've talked about address the mess. Now, if I was to walk into your abode right now, how organized is it?
It's really organized. It is. But part of it is like, I don't have a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff most of my stuff is in the storage unit in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
Most of my stuff.
If I was to walk into that storage unit in New York City,
that's pretty
how
organized
is that storage unit? Really?
It's really organized. Well, here's the thing. I won't go into the whole story about how all of my stuff ended up in a storage unit because I'm going to start crying if I tell the story. But suffice to say that when I first went into the, when all the stuff was thrown in there, I went to New York, I opened the door, gasped, shut the door, locked it, started crying, and went, I'm not going to deal with this. Well, then, from then, I started working as an organizer, and a couple of years later, I was back in New York and was like, I'm going to deal with this. So I opened the door, I got rid of two-thirds of the stuff that was in there, and the stuff that I wanted to keep is all there, nicely organized. If I needed to get something right now, I know exactly where it is. So it's just, having stuff organized just makes your life a little easier, and it's just kind of stressful
and
people don't know.
And bitching and coping.
Always. Always.
That seemed like a wishing and hoping and bitching and coping moment. Yeah,
it is.
That's
but
good.
You know,
that's good.
But it is. It's a great way to sort of, I just like look at my place. I look around my place and I go, oh, that looks really good. There's nothing like when it gets messy. If I'm really busy and start throwing things on the floor, I walk in my door and I go, oh God.
Now see, I do that sort of. I've done it from time to time for friends as well. And I'll help them particularly like with closets. Because that's where I find people really,
they suffer.
Where their childhood is, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's their therapy room. And so I tell people, I say, okay, we're going to hit this closet, you and I. And I remember it's a wonderful actor, older friend, who's since passed. God, everybody I know is dead. David, are you alive? Hello, David? David,
still
are you
here
there?
And I intend to be here for many years.
Thank you.
So you're not going to tell the story about me someday. Go ahead.
I'm not going to kill you. No. Right. King Stewart, real name, King Stewart. I knew him from Theater Geo. I helped him clear out this closet. And at one point, we discovered that it was actually a walk-in closet. I had no idea it was a walk-in closet until we cleared it out. It was that bad.
Yeah.
I said, okay, we're going to have three categories here, King. We have, do you want it? Do you need it? And what were you thinking?
Yes.
And do you want it, do you need it, or negotiable? The what were you thinking category is non-negotiable.
Go.
You have
it
to agree
goes,
these terms before we start. What
it's
do you think?
It's like what not to wear. Yeah. No, absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And what's great
and
about it, though,
I'll
is that you come
to,
in as a, you come in as sort of you really, it's not that you don't care about his stuff, but you'll never care about his stuff the way he does. So it's very easy to come in and be like, that is,
I'm
that's
not emotionally
your color, or Right. That doesn't work. It's got holes in it. Mm-hmm. I don't care if you paid $2,000 for it. It looks awful. You've got to get rid of it. You wear it? No, you don't. You like it? No, you don't. My mother gave it to me. Well, she's not here right now, so, you know, get rid of it. You need the space. It's all those sort of questions that you sort of throw at people.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, I have to admit, David, sometimes, not often, but sometimes of what you were thinking category choices were something that I like personally and I wanted. Is that bad?
Well, then you take it. When you get it back and they decide to give it up, do you take it home and then?
Well, hell yes.
Yeah, that's my thought. Okay.
Is it bad?
I've seen some of those things on you. But I don't judge.
And you thought, what,
I don't
and you
judge.
Think, what were you thinking? Yeah, I know.
I may think it, but I will not say it out loud.
I can see it in your face.
You happy,
don't tell, you'll never play poker. You'll never play poker and win in Vegas. I can see it in your face. So, now, is this grown into a nice little side business for you?
Well, you
notice
know,
how my voice went up when I said it?
Nice
business for you?
For you? Does that help you, David?
Does that help you, David?
It's not something I pursue on a daily basis, and I have clients that, you know, call me periodically to do a different room or whatever. And I have not thrown myself 3,000% into it, but when I do when I do the work and I do get a lot of referrals, it's great and I love it and I dedicate myself to it and I always make sure that when I leave there, people's lives are better. That's the best part of it, is that people don't realize sometimes when they're in the middle of all that crap that they think, well, I'm just used to it. It's like, well, then let's get you unused to it and make it better.
Exactly.
You know?
Doctor, it hurts when I do this. Well, stop doing that.
You know, like, why is there food in the bathroom cabinet? Well, it's just we just put it there and we forget about it. Well, let's get it out of there and let it be
what,
a bathroom
of that,
cabinet.
That's weird. Yeah, right. What is the most unusual space that you've been asked to help declutter? Was it a dungeon? Like you had to have a safe word or something?
No, I always wish somebody would, like, some sort of sex club or something would ask me to do that. I would love that. The strangest one, truly, was the women's cancer lab at Cedars-Sinai.
Really? How did that happen?
Yeah, because a friend of mine is an administrator at the women's cancer unit at Cedars, and he said, you know, their lab, and I've worked for him at his house, and he said their lab is a mess. You know, just disorganized. Not a mess, like dirty, but just a mess.
How did he really say it? Oh, David, the lab is a mess.
He said it was a mess. And so I came in, like, and I couldn't do, like, what I would do with a client, which would be, like, you know, like, oh, no, those needles, you do use those needles, get rid of those needles. I don't know what they use them for. So they had a woman who sort of was
needles don't match
like,
your
why
shoes.
Is that
incredible.
There? I'd be like, why is that there? She'd be like, because that's where the terminal patients are. Like, okay, then we're not going to move it. You know, like that kind of thing. But it was great. Like when I left, I felt like they felt like there was a little more. Like it just makes their work easier when you reach for something and it's there, not when you have to go there and then over there and then over there. You know,
that's what I always said about men. It's always helpful when you reach for something, it's there.
Well,
you know?
Yeah. God
I'm just saying.
For all of us all the time.
Thank you, Jesus.
In our lonely existence.
Well, that's terrific.
You know?
Wow, what an unusual, that just, that. How long ago was that?
You know, I don't even know.
It
started like
them.
6 years ago or so and on and off. And, you know, when I go out of town or when I get a gig that takes up all my time or whatever, then I don't do it. But,
but the
Cedars-Sinai
one, that gig, how long ago was that? And have you been able to go back and see a follow up with them and see if
that was about 5
they,
years ago. No, I haven't.
Uh-huh.
I haven't. But
maybe it's time, David.
No, I mean,
maybe it's time.
I left him in a good space, I believe. So, who knows?
As you do with everywhere that you go, you leave it a better.
There's somebody from the women's cancer unit listening to your show right now, going, oh, geez, we were so glad when he left.
What the hell? We're screwed.
You know, there's somebody listening, going, oh, geez.
Yeah. What the hell? Yeah. Now, what, you know, I love, because, you know, I always ask my guests to send me a ton of information, you know, their special interests, causes, things like that. And there's always some really, really fascinating nugget that sort of jumps out at me. And I thought this was really, really cool, because I didn't know that you had done this. One of my favorite sites, and you may not know the web address, but it's called HuffingtonPost.com. Yeah.
Sure.
Not the Huffington Post series.com, David. HuffingtonPost.com. Yeah, and you wrote this wonderful, wonderful letter that they posted called an open letter to the closeted leading man. And I'm going to read just an excerpt of the very beginning of it, and I want to talk about that a little before we carry on and get into our Just the Tip segment, which is coming up shortly. Yes, you're going to love that one. Now, this open letter to the closeted leading man. It starts off, "Dear A-list or A-list on the cusp leading man, I'll get right to it. You're gay. Are you tired of hiding yet? Come out of the closet. No matter what the conventional wisdom says, it's important that you come out. I'll get to the why for your own good later. But we need you as a role model. We need kids to see that you can be out and a success as high as the level will go." Of course, it goes on for longer than that, but I was like, kudos to you, you know, because that's a really controversial. There's a real strong feelings on both sides of that sort of issue, and I have to say that I lean a lot more towards where you are at this point, because there are certain people up there, certain performers, and some of them have talk shows and haven't come out yet, and I think it's important at this day and age that we make it a non-issue, and we show that others that we can be really successful and have not, because I think you pointed out Neil Patrick Harris is a perfect example, and Knight from Grey's Anatomy.
T.R. Knight, Well, look, you know, that article, I posted that article, what is it, like 4 years ago now, 5 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
And it's
yeah.
funny, except for some of the references, it still stays pretty timely in that,
absolutely.
You know, they're coming out, like, you know, they're coming out in droves. They certainly are.
Yeah.
But, you know, but more and more and more. And it's the kind of thing that if everybody in this industry who was gay would just say, yeah, okay, I'm gay, everything would blow over so fast it's not even fun.
In one day. If they all came out, the very next day it would be so blasé. It'd be like, whatever.
And nobody's career.
You know?
The thing started. You know Greg Hernandez, Greg in Hollywood. It's a great blog. He does. Okay, it's a great blog. I think it's greginhollywood.com. So definitely check that out. But he and I were sitting next to each other at a play at the Celebration. We were talking about, you know, A-list celebrities. And I specifically meant men more than women because, you know, a woman comes out and it doesn't hit the same way in the, like, you know, middle America, redneck, place as it is with men coming out, you know, fairies and faggots and this and that, you know, all that.
Right.
So we were talking about it. And he said, well, you should write it and I will if I'll post it on my blog. And he did. He posted it there first, and then I thought, you know, I really would like to get this on Huffington Post, so I sent it off to Ariana Huffington, and sure enough, she's like, here's what you do, and I put it up, and that's the only thing I've ever posted, but it was that important to me to say, you have to come out. I know that people like are always like, well, it's nobody's business, and you know, I like to keep things private, but the minute you show up at an opening with your wife, or you show up, you know, there's no privacy. I mean, you know, you can have
but
your
privacy.
But
you brought up a really good point. What about your partner? What about your boyfriend? What about your girlfriend who's at home? You're gay, but you're showing up with somebody of the opposite sex.
With your mom.
As your quote-unquote partner or with your mom or whatever. And the person that you're sleeping, you know, with, who's that person that you're intimate with, that person that you love, that person that you want to share your life with, and you can't share your entire life with them? For what reason?
Look, it's very, you know, the bottom line is the bottom line. You know, a lot of people's careers, they'd be afraid to do it because they feel like it might affect, you know, their power in the industry and their bottom line and everything.
Yeah.
And look, you know, you and I, we've seen, you know, a certain amount of success, but we're not these gigantic successes that they are. Well, I wouldn't say successes, but we're not as big as they are. And we don't enjoy all the, you know, we get our choices of our projects and we can make all that money. You know, there's something to be said for living your life with an agenda in order to get what you want. But to me, you know, in this industry, I haven't been in the closet a day in my life because I can't do that. There's something about living an authentic life outside of the business that makes me feel more real in the business. You know, when you feel like you have secrets to hide, that can't be an easy thing to do. And the higher you climb up the ladder, it gets harder and harder.
And I've admired that about you. And I've that's another thing that I've done for myself personally is I've never lived one moment in the closet. Now, yeah. My parents back in Canton, Ohio, you know, that was a little rough for them for a while,
of
I'm
course.
Sure.
You
but,
know,
you know, but
you
they've,
know,
learned,
well,
they've learned to grow, and they've learned to, to you know,
right. And I think
embrace
that, you know,
it as much as they can.
I have great parents. I have
yeah.
great parents, and yet they weren't, you know, they didn't just, like, when I told them I was gay, they weren't like, yay, let's have a party. They weren't, you know, it wasn't that. But over the years, when they've seen how, because I lived my life authentically, and because they knew
yes.
I was devoted to this career and to, you know, trying to find loving people in my life, they're like, that sort of softened them to everything, so that now, you know, they're my biggest fans. And even when they questioned my choices sometimes in the projects that I do, because I love, you know, I've done a bunch of sort of gay independent films, I've done a couple of gay plays, and they're like, why do you have to keep doing those? Why? And I really never had an answer for them until I went and did the question and answer at the opening of Scrooge and Marley, and somebody said, you know, the same thing my parents said. I said, you know what? Here's the answer. It's because we have tons of stories to tell, stories you don't even know about, and I think it's important to tell all those stories. So it's not like you can do five gay movies and boom, all the stories are told. No.
And then our story's been told. Yeah, exactly. But that's
right.
Brilliant.
There's a million stories,
that is brilliant.
Just like there's a million stories
right.
of straight people.
Well,
you know?
Yeah.
And so, and to me, it's like I like to tell those stories because you already know all those straight people's stories. You know, we've heard them. You don't know
yeah.
all the gay people's stories. And
yeah.
now there's so much happening, like, in the transgender community that's becoming more and more, you know, on TV and everything. And that's something that people didn't know much about, you know, general America. And now they are. They're learning. So there's all kinds of aspects
yeah.
to our communities that we have an opportunity to tell those stories and have people go, oh, I know somebody like that.
Yeah, well,
or, oh,
I'm hoping,
yeah,
speaking of, the Los Angeles Gay and Lesbian Center on Schrader in Hollywood, at the works, there's a young lady, transgender individual named Amanda, who works at the Jeffrey Goodman Center there, who I think from Saudi Arabia. Wonderful, wonderful young lady. It's got quite a story. In this most recent issue of The Vanguard, which is their, I don't know if it's a weekly or monthly publication, I'm hoping to get her on to tell her story. Because, yeah, that is a part of our community that's starting to really, whose story is finally starting to be told and getting the level of respect and dignity that they deserve. And she's got such an amazing story of perseverance that I really am hoping to get her on an upcoming episode to bring her on. So I'm glad that you mentioned that. Yeah, and then, you know, some of the other and, of course, you know, living the authentic life that you're living, that you're also very involved in any LGBT rights-related issues, gay marriage, bullying, and those stupid discriminatory laws that they've been trying to, or bills and laws they've been trying to pass in Arizona and Kansas.
Okay,
exclusivity
you're gay,
laws.
We're not going to make you a cake.
Right. But, you know, I'm
can
glad that you mentioned what you said
word?
About your parents embracing your work, because, you know, just a couple of episodes ago, we had Shangela, DJ Pierce, who was on seasons 2 and 3 of the RuPaul's Drag Race. And I was just watching the latest episode of season 6 of Drag Race, and one of the drag queens on the show, they did a little excerpt where there was a video excerpt that came up on the screen, and where they were all in their little lounge, and it was one of the drag queens' parents, and they took the moment to sort of really tell him, hey, you know, it's been a real journey for us, and we haven't always understood or supported you in the way that you needed. But we are now, and we've gotten to see a lot of what this drag race is all about, and we're really excited for you, and we hope at the end of it that RuPaul says the next drag star is, you know, and he said his drag name. And it was wonderful to see that story being told, like you said, seeing that particular story being told. And thank you for giving
everybody
voice
has,
to that.
Everybody has a story. And everybody's story, you know, and a lot of it has to do with, you know, getting over some kind of, you know, difficulty, some kind of conflict. And the fact that there are people out there who are trying to make your life even harder as you try to get through your conflict, everybody's got something. Even these, like, you know, goddamn, you know, conservative, right-wing, Midwest Bible beaters, you know, they have issues in their lives, too. And,
sure they do.
You know,
sure they do.
But they're the ones who do the judgment, so they're almost immune to the fact that anybody thinks that they're creepy, you know, because they're too busy spewing.
Yeah.
But if they would just sit for 1 second and go, God, you know, my life, I have things in my life, whether it's a family thing or a money thing or a health thing, that is so difficult right now. Why would I need somebody looking at me and saying, "You're an asshole. You're an idiot. You know, you shouldn't live. You're less than me." Why does anybody need that in their life? They don't. Nobody does. And so the fact that there are certain communities that get picked on more than others, you know, the LGBTQ community is just like, you know, the group of choice right now. And it's amazing to me that anybody has to waste their time looking at us and going, "You're less than me because the Bible tells me so." Well, you know what? Look at your own life. Look at your issues in your own life.
I've got news for them. The Bible doesn't tell them so. Anyway,
which is
a perfect segue into one of your other special love projects, which is called the I Am Love Project, which is helping to bring a production of Corpus Christi that you're involved with to towns around the country, and to have forums bring together people to discuss rights in their communities. And people can go to 108productions.org, that's 108productions.org, to find out more about the I Am Love Project. And I was fortunate enough several years ago to see a production of that, of Corpus Christi, here at the Elephant Theater, I think it was in Hollywood.
Oh, that was not our production, though.
No, but it was terrific.
That was great. You know, but we've been doing our production now on and off for almost 7 years, and we've done it all over the country. We've done it in Europe, and the show itself is just so, you know, it's essentially a gay Jesus character, but
it
for
is.
Me. You know, it's for somebody who, you know, I'm Jewish, those stories really mean nothing to me, you know. But the story is being told in such a beautiful way. And people who are religious, it was a way for Terrence McNally to sort of bridge his beliefs, you know, his religious beliefs with being a gay man. Because, you know, you go to some churches, they'll be like, "I'm sorry, they're totally mutually exclusive. You know, you can't be both." And he's like, "But I am both.
Yeah.
And how do I do this so that the world doesn't look at me and want to stone me?"
Mm.
And that was his way of, you know, finding this story. It's a beautiful play, and we do a really beautiful production. So we'd like to continue taking it to cities, you know, smaller towns where people don't get to hear this voice, you know, saying, "We love you. You are loved just the way you are. You can be religious, and you can have, you know, a full life. You don't have to compromise anything." And, you know, and again, have these, you know, crazy Bible beaters tell you, "No, love the sinner, hate the sin. Screw you. You know what? Screw you." I get very angry when I hear things like that, but that's what they hear in those
towns.
You're
an artist, David. You're a very passionate person, and I get that, you know. And I appreciate that passion.
I was going to say the F word, but I didn't know if I could do that or not. So
you could say fuck all you want on the show, because, you know,
fuck you, Bible beaters.
That's right. Beat those Bibles to their dust. Now, but tell us about the one really touching moment during one of the performances of Corpus Christi. I need to eat. Oh,
we
I need some crispy
that.
Chicken. Corpus Christi. Yeah. It was bound to happen. That's comedy. A really touching moment where a member of the audience was really overcome with emotion and had a particular reaction to one of the scenes.
Mm-hmm. We were at the Zephyr Theater in Los Angeles. This, you know, this great little
theater.
On Melrose, yeah. And in the play, you know, it plays out. It starts out as the story of a boy in 1950s Corpus Christi, Texas. But he's essentially the character of Jesus. And as the play goes on, the story of this boy and the story of Jesus sort of totally come together. And in the end, he is what happened to Jesus? He was crucified. And there's a whole crucifixion thing. Hardly. So there's that moment in the play, and it's a really emotional moment, and somebody from the audience came out of the audience, went up to where Brandon, the guy who played Jesus, was, you know, standing, and he kissed his feet. Crying.
I get teary-eyed just from reading that, because I am not a religious person, and I'm certainly not that religion.
When something is that personal to that man and that audience, when that is so important to him, when he is hearing a voice saying, you believe this, and Jesus loved you. I mean, he needed to hear that, and he was able to come out and express it like we have never seen before. And after that happened, we were like, you know what? We have more power here than we thought we did in telling the story.
Well, that's the universe telling you. I mean, that's pretty bold. It's Sometimes, you know,
sometimes
the universe puts a pebble at you. Sometimes it's the rock.
Yeah.
And that was the rock. That was the brook. Yeah. So
yeah.
That's just beautiful. So now let's zip. We're going to zip right through some things because I want to be able to get to the music at the end of the show. But you're also involved with Broadway Cares, Equity Fights AIDS, which has been going on for quite some time, and they do an amazing job at raising funds to fight the AIDS. And I've gone to many shows.
Since I've been in L.A., I haven't been able to work with them, but I used to work
right.
with them a lot in New York, and I miss them.
York,
I miss
absolutely.
Doing those benefits. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's pretty amazing. It's wonderful. And that's one of the things about New York that I always I learned to love right away and that I missed immediately is that immediacy of being able to relate to the artist so readily in the theater, on the streets and all that. It just you're always around artists and you're able to see the people that were in the shows on the streets, and it's really exciting.
It's
one of the greatest things about New York City. But
the streets of New York are the great equalizer.
Mm-hmm. Yes, just like the discotheques were in the great age of disco.
Yep.
Yes, the great equalizer. We were all in
Elijah.
Elijah Studio 54. Yes, we just watched the disco, a secret disco revolution. It's a documentary. You can see it on Netflix, Secret Disco Revolution. And talk about the great democratizing of music in our cultures in America. It brought a lot of people together on the dance floor of all different kinds of walks and races and whatnot. Yeah, so talk about the great equalizer. And it happened in New York, of course. That was a big scene. But I love your – speaking of equalizers, let's look at your bucket list. The first thing on David Pevsner's list and his bucket list, the very first thing, not curing cancer, not going bungee jumping, not, finding, the second hope diamond, but be in a gay porn film. Be in a gay – but not just anyone, ladies and gentlemen, the best gay porn ever. Or a film like Short Bus that has real sex but makes a great film. So I got it. I understood what you meant.
You know,
So tell us why that is so.
Well, because everything that I write, a lot of what I write has a very sexual bent to it. And people sort of know me. They make jokes about, like, oh, he's always shirtless. Well, I'm not always shirtless, However,
I've seen you wear shirts a couple of times.
A couple of times.
Like tonight.
But I've also found that, expressing, expressing your physicality, expressing your sexuality is something that, is difficult for a lot of people to do. And it was getting over my shame about my body was a really big deal to me and starting to feel proud about it. And, I always like to say that there's enough dirt in my life to kill 12 careers. Well, I post
for
photographers and there's, yeah, exactly. I post for photographers. I've done, I just think it's really important to sort of celebrate your sexuality. And if people are like, oh, I couldn't do that, I totally get it. But it's like when I did that show.
Remember when you celebrated your sexuality as a centaur in When Pigs Fly?
Well, that show was so PG. It was G rated though. Really,
Yeah. Yeah,
it was
but when I did that, David,
I was
the tail end. I was my friend Gerard Labeda. He will kill me if I don't mention this. But I was the tail. I was the butt in that costume. Yeah, that was lucky me. Lucky me had to be the tail end.
Michael West,
of the centaur.
Michael West was the because that's the Howard Carr tail end in the centaur.
Yeah.
And I'm people don't know it's the half man half horse. And so that, and with these great hooves that you have to walk on, and there's the guy who's the back of the horse underneath the costume. And so Michael
staring
West, I always joked, exactly staring at my ass. So I said to Michael West, I could pass gas like any second now, and you can't go anywhere.
Right?
And he goes, and all of a sudden I feel the back of the horse costume sit down. And goes, anytime that happens,
I was always a little nervous that Gerard had maybe the burrito, and all of a sudden it was just going to happen, and I was just going to be like, no.
But Michael was hilarious. He goes, if that happens, David, and he just sits down, and I can't move. So I was like, okay,
that's right.
Happen, Michael, I promise.
Yeah.
Promise.
So, yeah. So I should have thought of that. Damn. Too late. Too late.
Too late.
But anyway, so I got my one little fart sound in there. So, hey, I did a good job. Yeah, so that's it. So being a gay porn, but not just anyone. Not just anyone.
No.
You want to go to Australia.
I thought Short Bus was fantastic. And there was a movie on.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, I just tripped over. They showed a scene of it. I don't know if you ever saw a movie called Intimacy. It's a film with Mark Rylance and Kerry Fox, and it is pretty graphic in the sexuality of the movie, very graphic. But it's so amazing because it's this man and this woman who have these sort of casual, almost anonymous flings, and you sort of go like, well, why are they doing this? Because they're really passionate until he follows her home and sees what a shitty life she has, and you go, wow, you have to show the passion of that sex in order to sort of, you know, put it against what she deals with in her real life. And to me,
wow.
You know, sexuality and you know, showing, you know, people, a lot of times people are like, well, you don't need to see that. You need to infer. No, you know what? No. Sometimes you need to see it. Sometimes it can make a point.
Yeah.
And that's
the thing that I would
love to do someday. And, you
well,
know,
I
wrote a movie actually that has some of that. And
now, is
you
this
know,
the film
of
that
course,
you want to have
when
made?
You write something, what'd you say?
Is this the film that you want to have made? As well as your one-man musicals? Because I know that's also on your list.
Right. I wrote a movie that has 10 short films in it. It's sort of like a gay film festival. And one of the films is
film festival.
Of like a porn, but it's a very funny short film.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I'm hoping that we can shoot it exactly as I intend to, because I think it's so funny that the sexuality of it will just become part of the discomfort / humor.
Well, maybe Jeffrey Johns can help you do that, since he seems like he's doing, and you're a doer, so maybe put two doers together and you can get it done.
Who?
Your musical.
Jeffrey Johns. Jeffrey. Yeah.
Who?
Who knows?
Hello. Is this David Pevsner? Hello, David. Could David come to the line, please?
Here.
Oh, David, you're so cute. See, you always go back. You can always go back to that. Yes. Now you want to get all your songs recorded as well. Have a boyfriend for more than 3 months. Learn to cook and take ballet classes again. And I can tell you from right now, you have that boyfriend for more than 3 months. You'll learn how to cook. Period. Because I've been in a relationship now for more than 4 months, and I've done more cooking than I've done in my whole life, and I've gotten really good at it.
Well,
so it'll happen.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you sort of kill two birds with one stone.
Well, I do ballet while
I'm
cooking, so that's kind of three. And I record your songs, so that's four. So
wow.
I'm working through your bucket list.
You're having
as
a better
speak.
Life than I am.
Well,
you're having a way better life
but
than
we balance it out with that intimacy that I'm having off screen. So, but I love, and let's zip through your favorite songs before we get to. We're going to go right from the our songs. We're going to skip past. No, we're just going to zip through. I love how you have Pain in the Butt, which is a fun song.
That's
now,
nice
can people
song.
Hear that online? That's written by you, another one of the songs that you wrote, Pain in the Butt, really cute song. Can they hear that online anywhere?
I think it might be on, I can't remember if it's on one of my, I think it is, one of my pages on my website. There are two pages called MCW, which means Musical Comedy Horror. And one of the, I think it's on one of the two pages. I could be wrong.
It is, but I think
it's
a
rough
repeat.
Demo.
You might want to, yeah. One of the songs plays twice, and I think I couldn't hear Pain in the Butt, but you sent me a rough demo of it. But check your site, check that out, because I think people need to hear that song. It's a lot of fun. So, and you love, I Never Have Seen Snow. I don't know that one by Barbra Streisand. What's that from?
Oh, my gosh. It was from her Barbra Streisand and Other Musical Instruments TV special. And it's really an amazing arrangement. It's just beautiful, really beautiful.
Yeah.
And it's from A House of Flowers, I want to say, is the song. Just a beautiful arrangement, and she never sounded better. It's really, you know, I'm an old Streisand fan, you know.
You are, because you also love her duets that she does with herself, which I think is brilliant. One Less Bell to Answer and A House Is Not a Home. So, like, you know,
yeah,
who can sing this song better than me? I don't know. Who do I want to sing with? Who do I want to sing with? Oh, I want to sing with me. I'll sing with me.
No,
I'm
you know what?
Better.
I I have this friend who's, I have a friend, I take a singing performance class with a wonderful teacher named Carol D'Andrea. And there was a kid who joined the class, and he's a singer. He's sort of like a Latin Justin Bieber type thing that, you know, they're hopefully, you know, going to make him, they're sort of turning him into this, you know, pop star.
Uh-huh.
And I'm driving him home from a screening of a movie, and I asked him, you know, have you ever listened to Barbra Streisand? He's like, well, no, not really. I said, okay. Okay.
Oh,
and
right.
So I had a copy of her duets album. Well, I just said,
yeah,
there's a certain thing you got to hear of her, because if you really want to hear good singing, that's good singing.
Right.
So I played him that duet. And he's not, you know, he's like a straight guy who doesn't like, you know, he's really trying to learn different kinds of music. He couldn't believe it. He was just like, where did that come from? I mean, not only the singing, but the arrangement, because I think it was Peter Matz who arranged it. Just everything about it is like, you don't hear that kind of thing anymore. You just don't.
No, you don't. No, you don't.
Nope.
No, and so I love that. Yeah, so if people want to go back and listen to, I mean, she's got a ton of albums, of course. But, yeah, that's one thing that she's meticulous about. She really is so good at finding such fantastic arrangements.
Those first few albums with Peter Matz arranging them, you know, Peter is no longer with us, but that man was a genius.
Yeah.
He was a genius. Yeah. And you listen to stuff that she, you know, I think he also, I want to say, I could be wrong, but when they didn't work together for a long time, but then when she did the Broadway album, he worked on some of that.
Oh.
And putting
it
together,
the opening
number, I think
it's him.
You know, I was
in college when that came out, and that was such an influential album for me. That was such a major album for me.
I used to just sit
in my dorm room at night and just play it, turn the light off and just lay in my bed and just play the entire album. And it was like going to another place. It was just so beautifully done. And it was just one of those meditative kind of experiences. So, yeah, I'm glad that you bring her up. And then rounding off your favorite song list, which I just love, is The Rainbow Connection, sung by Kermit the Frog, which I absolutely love, and The Climb, sung by Miley Cyrus, another good song. But The Rainbow Connection, so sweet. I remember that. That song was just, that meant a lot to me as well. So I think we live parallel lives.
I just heard you sort of skirting over the whole Miley Cyrus thing. Here's the thing. So I'm in my car one day, and I'm like switching channels, and all of a sudden I hear this song, and I'm listening going, oh my God, I fucking love this song. What the hell is this? And it turns out it was Radio Disney, and it was Miley Cyrus. I was like, what, are you kidding me? It's just such a great song. And people listening would be like, really, this decline? But, you know, it really is a great song.
But I'm more concerned
that
you have Radio Disney
it.
On your radio.
Well, I was just clicking past it, and then I found that I sort of like enjoyed listening to Radio Disney.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Because they have songs. It's not like, you know, you can't even find anything that has a melody and a lyric line to it anymore, so.
No kidding, it's
whatever.
Like, you know, it's all like just like people are constipated or they're enjoying themselves and nobody else is in the room, if you know what I mean.
Yeah,
so,
that's what people seem. That's what the kids seem to like, Michael, so I don't know what to tell you.
I know. Well, I'm going to put my teeth back in for the rest of the show. There we go.
Here's me too. I'm going to put the horn in my ear so I can hear better.
You
should. Okay. Thank you.
Now, we're going to segue.
Here we go.
Ooh, we're going to magically segue into our last segment before we go to some wonderful music that will just tingle your heart. Now, this is just the tip, okay? This is where our featured guest, that's you, David Pevsner, and I, the host, OMTG, give our audience just enough information to get them started. Now, after all, because, David, we are entertainment prostitutes. We're not whores. We don't just give it away for free. There is a small shipping and handling charge. Okay. Now, this is a very important tip.
I'm totally a C here.
Yeah. This is a very important tip this week. These are 8 celebrity sex tapes that nobody wanted to see.
Okay.
That's our list this week.
Are they real? They're real?
Oh, yeah. This is posted on thestir.cafemom.com. I'm a little disturbed that there's mom in this website title. Yeah, thestir.cafemom.com. 8 celebrity tapes no one wanted to see. Yes. Now, when you hear the phrase celebrity sex tape, certain images quickly come to mind. You think about a pair of impossibly hot people getting in front of a camera, right? Well, unfortunately, that's not always the case. There are plenty of not-so-gorgeous stars who like to capture those intimate moments. That's perfectly fine, of course. That
Which
isn't the freaky footage. But, well, Oh, good, good, good. I'm glad you're playing.
Yeah.
See, we don't always have to agree with the list and its tone. It's okay to disagree with the list. Okay, now here we go. The following is a list of 8 celebrity sex tapes, apparently, nobody wanted to see. But let's see if David has them in his collection. Okay, number 1. Here's Johnny. Like you've never seen him before. A raunchy rendezvous he filmed with his wife, I don't know which one because he was married like 8 times, is now being shopped around.
Joanna. Wow.
Oh, yeah. One source, yeah, he had like, what, 2 or 3 Joannas? One source
I
said the
so.
Tape leaves nothing at all to the imagination. Oh, my goodness. How did
you? I applaud it. I'm
you
giving
it
a standing ovation. Yeah.
You are. I think, because, you know, good for him, because, you know, he needs to enjoy himself. Why not? Here's Johnny.
Here's the thing. Okay, before you go any further, I love anything, unless it's, like, detrimental to, like, either health or illegal or something, I love anything that sheds a light on somebody that we don't know them as, you know, like.
No, that's a good point.
You know, some
yeah.
like some G-rated star, like who only makes family films, and all of a sudden there's a sex tape. I love that.
Oh, there you go.
Anything. It humanizes them to me.
Well, we have Hulk Hogan at number 2 here,
okay.
Which was released in 2012. We have,
well,
of course,
released
Paris
where?
Hilton.
Just on the internet?
I don't know. It says perhaps, but their opinion is very, you know, a little judgy. The thing, if it had been released in his prime like 20 years ago, this might have been somewhat
mm-hmm.
tolerable. However, watching the geriatric wrestler get his freak on in this 2012 tape is hard on the eyes. Hard on the eyes.
The
I pause between
eyes.
Hard on the eyes. Yeah.
I would probably love it, but go ahead.
Now, Paris Hilton's at number 3. I've never seen this one. But the weird thing about this one, you've probably seen some footage on this, is that it's considered one of the worst of all time because it was shot in the dark with a night vision lens.
Yeah, I've seen part of it.
Okay, and her eyes glow. Now, with all the money in the world, you'd think she would have had better production values, don't you think?
You'd
I'm just
think.
Thinking. Really?
I guess there's a charm in making it sort of, you know, sort of underground. Paris, underground, you know.
So to speak.
No.
Oh, no,
that's
number 4, David.
I've seen part of it. I don't need to see it again.
I have.
Go ahead.
Oh, no, my God, no. Number 4, I was not aware of. This is China, the person, not the country kids. The WWF
the
star
wrestler?
Showed off
yeah.
some. What's that now?
The wrestler.
Yeah, the wrestler. The WWF star showed off some unexpected moves in a sex tape with then-boyfriend Sean Waltman. She reportedly transformed her body into a hawking mass of muscle by the time she filmed One Night in China. It's truly one of the scariest sights ever, apparently. Yeah. I like the title,
wow.
though. One Night in
it's
China.
Perfect. And isn't she like
yeah.
C-H-Y-N-N-A or something?
Yes, C-H-Y-N-A, yeah. That's why I said
yeah.
the person.
So, that, so then you don't get confused that it's like a you know, like
yeah.
a documentary tour of China.
Like, oh, I went One Night in China, which is really not a long time. Because that's a big country.
Yeah.
You know,
so,
you want more
but because
money.
It's C-H-Y-N-A, it sort of sets
exactly.
you up to know that. Okay, got it.
You know that it's different.
Which,
number 5,
which
speaking of Y's in the names, speaking of Y's in the name, Tanya Harding, number 5. Didn't think things could get worse for this disgraced figure skater? Wait until you see the tape that sex tape her ex-husband, Jeff Galooly, sold to Penthouse. They were both sloppy drunk in the footage.
Yeah. See,
yeah.
if you're going to do a sex tape, if you're going to put a sex tape out there, at least, you know, at least try, you know,
yeah.
erotic
yeah.
or
I don't know, is it, yeah.
funny
I don't know
or
if they,
sexy.
You know, yeah. yeah. I don't know if that was really done with the intention of, you know, pardon the pun, releasing it. But
yeah.
there it is.
That was good,
no.
Michael.
Right?
That was
right.
very good.
I got a million of them. Now, number 6, Danielle Staub, S-T-A-U-B. I had no
yeah.
idea who this woman was. The former
Real Housewives.
Real Housewives of New Jersey. Yeah, of New Jersey.
Yeah.
She sunk to a new low when she taped this smash fest. What do they mean by smash fest? Does that mean like bodies bumping into each other kind of thing? Smash fest?
I don't know. I haven't seen that.
I haven't heard that.
And I sort of don't want to, but go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. So moving along. Number 7, Dustin Diamond. Remember him as Screech? Screech gone
wow.
wild in a 2006 video that showed some seriously nasty sex play. The Saved by the Bell star performed something called a Dirty Sanchez. ugh.
Oh, yeah.
So gross. If you don't know it, Google it. Do you know what a Dirty Sanchez is?
Yeah, I do. We're not going to talk about it, though. This is a family show.
Well, all I'm saying, kids, wipe from the front to the back, not the back to the front.
Oh.
And that's, we're going to leave it at that. Okay, I'm just saying. Number 8 and last on the list, before we end the show with some wonderful music, Vern Troyer, a.k.a. Mini-Me. The power star got busy with an average-sized woman in this surprising sexathon. It was reportedly leaked by a girlfriend who was trying to make a quick buck. Troyer filed suit to stop it, but clips made their way to the web. Okay, I mean, how many people are now, like, going online to try to find all these things? All I'm saying. I have a feeling.
Well,
I hear a little click, 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 click going online. Uh-huh. Yeah.
And they click on it and watch for about a second and then go, oh, I don't need to see that. Okay.
No, and then they're like,
look,
oh. Then they get
to
wash
their mouth
out with
vodka. So the ones who intended to make them and the ones who intended to put them out there and hopefully with some bit of finesse, I applaud you. That's all I can say.
Oh, David applauds you, and so does our studio audience.
You. Thank you. I don't judge.
Now, David, you know, we always like to end our show with music. Now, this week's Jukebox 5 is we'll just get you putting on your flared pants, your sparkle top, and your platform shoes. Yes. David, it's the true queen of disco, Ethel Merman, and we're going to light up the disco floor with All Merman All the Time, most wonderfully wacky, fun, entertaining, uplifting disco version of her greatest Broadway hits by the inimitable Ethel Merman from her disco LP, which was released in 1979 at the delightfully youthful age of 71. Nobody but Ethel Merman could have released a disco album at 71.
That's true,
okay?
And I had that album,
I know.
By the way.
Yeah, of course you have it. So number 5 on our list is There's No Business Like Show Business. Let's give it a listen. I love it. Now, David, since we're both musical comedy whores and just you know, theater geeks, I thought, and Broadway babies, I thought you would enjoy very much having a little Ethel Merman. Not just a little, a lot of Ethel. Are you ready for more?
Oh, yeah. You hear me?
Really? Yeah, I hear you. You're here? Are you there?
No,
David?
What's great about it is, you know,
yeah,
it's a whole different style of music behind her, but does she change her delivery that she did on Broadway in 1934?
No,
not at all. And that's what's so great about it.
It
not
is
a
wonderful. Not a, and if you want to see how she sticks to her guns, here's Everything's Coming Up Roses.
Oh, here we go.
Oh,
I love
okay, every
it.
Time that bass drum played, I literally burst out laughing. Boom, boom. That's it. I'm done.
Right.
I'm done for the
and
night.
She started
that's
shaking
about
those
the funniest
hips.
Thing I've ever
boom.
Heard.
Isn't it the greatest? Isn't it the greatest? And the picture of her on the album cover on a carousel throwing out her arms. She's on the ride of her life. It's just fantastic. And you're right. She just, it is a wonderful, it's a wonderful melding of musical genres and just the history that comes together all at the same time. And she's having a good time with it. Because you know what?
And it's insane.
Because
it's totally insane.
And you know what? She's got rhythm and she's here to prove it. Let's listen. And, you know, at 71, she still had those pipes.
71.
I mean, 71. I got rhythm. I got music.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
I love it. I'm just having such a good time with this. And I'm so glad because, I you're one of your co-stars from Old Dogs New Tricks. Amanda Gary is one of my favorite co-hosts on the show. She
love the video.
Did you have this album? She has a... Know it, I have it. I said, have it, I wrote it. So, no, yeah, everybody, those I know and love have this disc, as we call it, the
very
LP. Yeah, and as this next song will tell our audience, this is how we feel about Ethel. I get a kick out of you.
Mm.
David, I have so gotten a kick out of you this evening, being on the show.
Cool.
So I dedicate that song to you as well. So,
oh,
but she just sounded
moment.
Like she was having so much fun. Oh, well, my pleasure. She sounded like she was having so much fun on this album. And just like so much what we do and in our daily lives, and not just on the stage and in the film. But, you know, I appreciate the fact that you've been an out and proud, and just you've been a fully realized human being from the beginning, and that you there's nothing about you that you don't put on the table, and I really appreciate that about you very much.
Well,
so,
thank you. It's, you know,
my pleasure.
One day at a time, the ups and the downs, mm-hmm. but you know, you just gotta keep, you know, it just makes life easier when you don't have to hide, and
mm-hmm.
you know, when you don't have to hide and when you find stuff to laugh at, life is a lot better.
Absolutely.
For
and
me,
that,
I can't speak for everybody.
For me. And for you.
And for you.
But,
for me.
Yeah.
We should end up, we should
end,
let Ethel have the last word. For me.
She should, and she will, because, you know, just like Ethel, and just like we want to do something for the boys, and that'll be our final song in our Jukebox 5 selection in honor of our service men and women. But this is a wonderful song called Something for the Boys from Ethel Merman's disco album.
I love it.
What you got?
They're doing something for me. Oh, I love it.
And I believe that's a Cole Porter tune.
No kidding, right?
For the boy. Yeah.
He's doing something because they're doing something for him. Yeah. Oh my God. So I just want to say thank you to our show's producer, Christopher Taylor, our delectable co-host who's recovering at home this evening and couldn't join us, Miss Tuffet Schmelzy. We wish her a speedy recovery. But most of all, we want to thank tonight's delightful, delicious, and simply divoon featured guest, the incredibly engaging and entertaining David Pevsner. And for more information about our shows, you're welcome, honey. My pleasure. Now, people can find out more information about our shows and topics. Just go to lnrradio.com. Remember to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Spreaker.com, and share with everyone you know. Thanks for tuning in to OMTG on the LNR Radio Network. We are broadcasting a lively, sparkling new Broadway show every Wednesday. Tune in and turn on. Good night, everybody. And David, you're lovely. Keep working, and let's work together.
I will, and I'll see you at the gym tomorrow.
Yes. See you in the morning. Bye.
Bye.
Good night.